It seems there are walls standing in the way before us that have kept us from experiencing all that God has for us. There are some of us even here today that have been waiting a long time for their breakthrough. But what you're about to hear today, I believe, is going to catapult you through that wall, through that barrier, through that thing that has been holding you back. You see, a breakthrough happens. Every breakthrough that has ever occurred in history has happened through a discovery. So when you think about all of the medical breakthroughs that have happened, for example, the breakthrough of the cure for polio, the breakthrough of a cure for the Black Plague, the bubonic plague years ago, the breakthroughs that have occurred medically happened because there was a discovery made. The breakthrough of power being harnessed in our world happened through a discovery of electricity and how electricity works. The electricity and the power was always there, but the breakthrough occurred when somebody discovered how the power worked. Somebody discovered how to release the power. We talked a little bit about that last Sunday, if you recall. But whenever there is a discovery, there is always a breakthrough. As I look back in my life, the first breakthrough that I ever had as a human being was when I discovered God's love. When I discovered God's love, I had a breakthrough, and I no longer lived under the curse of rejection. I no longer lived under the curse of loneliness. When I discovered God's love, I had a breakthrough into acceptance and into peace and into a life free from loneliness and free from depression and discouragement. When I discovered God's love, it catapulted me into a breakthrough. That was the first time I ever had a real breakthrough where I could finally have a real sense of self-worth and value and a peace of mind that came from knowing that I was loved. You see, the discovery of God's love, God had always loved me, but when I discovered that love, it catapulted me into a breakthrough in my life. So that was the first discovery that I ever had that brought a breakthrough in my life. Later in my Christian life, I finally discovered the meaning of the gift of righteousness. I didn't understand fully what righteousness meant, but when I discovered the gift of righteousness, God had already given it to me through the blood of Jesus, but when I discovered what it meant, it brought me into a life of victory. It brought me a breakthrough into a life where I was no longer condemned, a life where I was no longer living below and living beneath as the tail. Instead, when I understood the discovery of righteousness, I had a breakthrough into victory, and I realized I was the head and not the tail. I was above only and not beneath. You see, these are a couple of the breakthroughs that happened in my life, and both of them came because of a discovery. And the third breakthrough, real breakthrough in my life was when I discovered the grace of God, when I realized that I couldn't earn God's favor. I couldn't deserve God's favor. I couldn't work for God's favor. I knew I was saved by grace, but I didn't understand the magnitude of God's grace, how it encompassed every area of my life. I discovered grace, and it brought me into a greater breakthrough of peace, a greater breakthrough of confidence and favor and doors opening that no man could close. It caused me to realize that God's promises in my life were not promises that challenged me to perform better so that God would be good to me, but rather God's promises were an announcement of what he was going to do without me having to work for it, earn it, or deserve it. That was the grace of God that I discovered. And good things started happening in my life freely and more easily because I realized that they happened by God's grace. That grace comes from the Greek word charis, which is where we get the word charisma from. When somebody has quote-unquote charisma, what does that mean? They're gifted. There's just something about them. Things seem to happen for them easily, and it comes to them naturally. Well, that's what grace does. Grace is God's gifts to us. They're free gifts, starting with the gift of salvation, the gift of righteousness, the gift of favor, the gift of power, the gift of destiny, all of the gift of a future and a hope. Everything God gives us is a gift from him, and we need to be gift-minded and realize that our relationship with God is based on his generosity, not our performance. That's the breakthrough that I experienced when I discovered God's grace. And then there's the one that I want to get to today, the discovery of the treasure that was inside of me. when I realized at some point, and I want to talk to you about the treasure inside of you, discovering the treasure inside of you. When I realized that God put a treasure inside of me, it caused me to stop looking to other people to bring me happiness. It caused me to stop looking to other people to be my source, looking to other people to be the answer to my needs, the supply for my needs. I realized that God had deposited something inside of me, and He's deposited something inside of you. And the goal in life is not to obtain more things from God, but rather the goal in life is to uncover and discover that what He has already put inside of you, and the greatness that is inside of you, the treasure that is inside of you. 2 Corinthians 4:7 says, we have this treasure in earthen vessels. God has placed a treasure inside of every person here. I don't care if you just got out of prison. I don't care if you were the worst criminal or drug dealer on the earth. There is a treasure inside of you. When you're born again, there is a treasure that God places inside of your born again spirit. And our objective is to search and find the treasure that is within us, to uncover it so those treasures can be released to be a blessing to every person that we come in contact with. There is a treasure of greatness inside of you. There's a treasure of peace and joy and life and power that's on the inside of you. And the devil would love you to think that there's nothing good on the inside of you. You got to go look to people or look to other things or money or some outside source to find your destiny. But it's all been placed strategically and wisely on the inside of you where Satan can't get to it. God has hidden it on the inside of you. He has put hidden treasures on the inside of you that are there for you to discover so that you can then distribute those treasures to be a blessing to other people. And I'm going to show you the four or five ways to unlock those, to unlock that treasure, to discover that treasure and activate the treasure that's on the inside of you. But I want you to say this. Say, I have a treasure inside of me. Your breakthrough begins when you discover the treasure that is inside of you. There's a treasure in you. You're a treasure chest. You are a treasure chest. A few years ago, a Santa Fe, New Mexico resident, Forrest Fenn, who now is about 87 years old or so, he hid a treasure chest somewhere in New Mexico. He stocked it with gold coins and diamonds and sapphires and rubies and jewels from his personal collection. It was worth at the time over $2 million. It's probably worth way more than that now. The only clues to the treasure's whereabouts came in his book that he wrote entitled The Thrill of the Chase. He wrote this book in 2010, and inside of the book, there was a poem inside of the book where there are nine, you can still get this book and you can still go to New Mexico to try to find this treasure because nobody has found it since. And he gave 9 clues in this book, in this poem within his book, that indicate where the treasure is. And several people have come close to finding it, he says, but nobody has found it. And he says every year about 50,000 people come in the summer to try to search for this hidden treasure. Well, I have something better to tell you than a $2 million hidden treasure in New Mexico. You don't have to read a poem to figure out where the treasure is. You just have to read your Bible to figure out where the treasure is. Because the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 45, verse 3, in the New Living Translation, it says, and I will give you treasures hidden in the darkness, secret riches. You know, sometimes there are some dark areas of our lives, and sometimes we're going through dark times. And those dark times, maybe you've been through a divorce, maybe you've been through a sickness, maybe you've been through a financial disaster, maybe you've been through a sickness with your child, or something that has been a really dark time. And God wants you to know that it's in those dark times, if you'll search, if you'll dig deeper in the dark times, if you'll dig further in the dark times, if you'll look to God in the dark times, if you will trust in the dark times, there is a treasure that will be revealed to you in the darkness. It's hidden in the darkness. Instead of being afraid of the dark, instead of being worried about the dark, instead of shrinking back in troubled times and in dark times, that's the time to realize, whoa, there's darkness in my life. Whoa, I'm going through a dark patch in my life. Anybody been through a dark patch in your life? And you might think, whoa, I'm going through a dark season in my life. I'm going through a dark day, a dark night, a dark patch in my life. What is happening in those dark times? That's the time to realize there is a treasure hidden in the darkness. If you will trust God in the dark moments, trust God in the dark times, there's a treasure that God is waiting to reveal to you and wants to reveal to you. There are treasures inside of you. Say, I am filled with treasures. And God says, it's secret riches, and I will do this. Secret riches. Remember what Jesus said? He said, when you pray, pray in secret. And shut the door. And don't announce to everybody that you're praying. When you're going through a dark time, go pray. When you're anxious, it's a signal to pray. When it's dark, when it's a dark moment, it's a signal to pray, because there are riches in the secret moments, the secret times with God. Those times where you trust God when it doesn't look good. When I like what Job said, I think it was Job 13, verse 15. His head wasn't right, but his heart was. Because in Job 13, verse 15, he said, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. You see, his head was wrong. It wasn't God that had slayed him. It was Satan that had smote him, according to Job chapter 1. But in chapter 13, Job didn't realize it was Satan. Job thought God had brought this bad stuff upon his life. And yet, even though he thought God did it, he said, I'm still going to trust him. Though he slay me, yet will I trust him. How many know that God has been so good to you, God has been so kind to you, God has been so loving to you, and yet it's still hard for us to trust him sometimes. And here Job was thinking that God had slayed him, thinking that God had struck him and smote him with disease and disaster and boils and sores and the death of his children and the loss of his wife. And he thought, man, this is the worst season of my life. But he trusted God in the midst of it. And I pray that no matter how dark your moment is, how dark your hour is, that you'll trust God today. Trust him in the darkness. Trust him in those tough moments. Trust him when you feel slayed. Trust him when you feel that God is far from you, because he's not. The Bible says he is an ever-present help in your time of need. He's an ever-present help. He's not out there somewhere. He is present with you. He is Jehovah Shammah, the God who is there. Where is there? Wherever you are is there, and God is there. If you're in New Mexico, God is there. If you're in Chicago, God is there. Wherever you are, right now you're at Life Changers International Church, God is here. Amen. He's Jehovah Shammah. It's wherever you are, he's there, because he lives inside of you, and you have the treasure of the Holy Spirit inside of you. God could have chosen anywhere in this universe to live. He could have lived on another planet. He could have lived in another galaxy. He could have created another galaxy. But instead, he chose to live inside of you. He doesn't dwell in temples made with hands, but he dwells in human hearts made without hands, made and fashioned and shaped by our Heavenly Father. He lives inside of you. And I want you to know that we're going to unlock that treasure today. I'm going to show you four or five things to discover the treasure that's inside of you. And that's why I want to take you to 2 Kings chapter 4. 2 Kings chapter 4, we're going to look at the woman. Remember the woman who, her husband had died, and the creditors were coming to take her sons as slaves for payment. And in verse 1, it says, she cried out to the prophet Elisha, saying, your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant feared the Lord. And the creditor has now come. The creditors have come to take my sons to be his slaves as payment. And I want you to see what has now become one of the most famous statements in the Bible, the question that the prophet Elisha asks the woman when she says, I don't have any money to pay my bills, and the creditors are coming to take my sons as slaves for payment. Elisha says to her, what do you want me to do for you? Tell me, what do you have in your house? What do you have in your house? What do you want me to do for you? He says, look, what God wants to do for you happens when you discover what God has already put in your house. The thing that God wants to do in your life happens through a discovery of what is already in your house. He says to her, what do you have in the house? What do you have in the house? What do you have in the house? This is the secret to your breakthrough, is he pointed her to her own house. Sometimes we don't realize what we have. We don't even use what we have until we're in a crisis. A crisis or a problem in your life is not something to be worried about, but rather a crisis or a problem in your life is a signal that God has made provision on the inside of you. If you will learn how to draw the treasures out from within you, you can handle any crisis. If you will realize what's inside of you, you can handle any crisis. So we used to think that people are our answer. Finding the right husband, finding the right wife, finding the right job, finding the right, electing the right president, having the right government. Somehow someone else is gonna bring us the answer. But the prophet didn't point to the king. He didn't point to the president. He didn't even point to heaven. He pointed to her house and said, "What do you have in your house? The answer you need is already within you. It's not within you before you're saved, but once you're saved, God puts it inside of you. There's a treasure inside of you, and here is the first secret to discovering the treasure inside of you. It happens when you shift your thinking from what you don't have to what you do have. When you shift your thinking from what you don't have to what you do have. So secret number one to discovering the treasure in you is shift your thinking from what you don't have. I don't have enough money to pay my bills, and I owe this money, and they're gonna take my sons. And what did Elisha do? He got her to shift her focus and to shift her thinking on what she did have rather than what she doesn't have. And this is the secret to life. We've gotta start out prayer. Is often most Christians start out prayer with what they don't have. Oh God, I need this, and oh God, will you do this? But God wants us to start praying with the prayer of thanksgiving. Oh God, thank you that you gave me this, and thank you for what you did in my life there, and thank you for how you saved me here, and thank you for what you cleansed me from here, and thank you for what you prevented me from there and protected me from here. And remember the 10 lepers, they were all cleansed, but only one turned back, and when he turned back, he gave thanks. He didn't come back and say, "Now I want more, Lord, I want more." He said, "Thank you for what you've already done." You see, he shifted his thinking from what he needed to what God had already done for him. And this is what we need to do. We need to shift our thinking from what we don't have to what we have. This is how miracles happen. This is how breakthroughs occur. Shift your thinking. Everybody say, shift your thinking. Shift your thinking. This is the secret to discovering the treasure in you. It starts when you start shifting your thinking. Start shifting your thinking from what you don't have to what you do have. The prophet did not start with something in heaven or something on earth. He started with what was in her house. It's not other people. It's not other things. It's what you already have in your house. It's not the government. It's what you already have in your house. It's not who is elected. It's what you already have in your house. It's not what's in heaven. It's what you already have in your house. It's not what's coming later. It's what you already have in your house. We have to shift our thinking. There's something you have. There's money in your couch somewhere, right? You have a Bible on your shelf. Use your Bible. You have a tongue that brings healing. The Bible says the tongue of the wise brings healing. And in Proverbs 18:21, it says death and life are in the power of the tongue. Guess what? You have death. You have the ability to bring death to sickness, death to fear. Your tongue has the power to bring death. And there are some things we need to kill with our tongue, not each other, but there are some things in our life we need to kill with our tongue. And then there are some things we need to bring to life with our tongue. Remember, he told Ezekiel, prophesy to these dry bones, Ezekiel. Speak to these dry bones and declare life to them. Breathe the breath of life over them. Declare to them, oh, dry bones, the Spirit of the Lord says, come alive and come up out of the grave. And so he spoke the words of life, and the dry bones began to come together. You see, you have a treasure. Your tongue is a treasure. Your tongue brings life. Your tongue brings death. Your tongue is powerful. You see, we have to shift our thinking from what we don't have to what we do have. How do we do that? Well, one of the things that I would encourage you to do is start taking inventory of what's in your life. Take inventory of what God has already given you. And so the secret number one to discovering the treasure in you is shift your thinking from what you don't have to what you do have. And secret number two is begin to take inventory. Start taking inventory about what you have. You know, if you ever ran a business, one of the things you do every few months or every year is you take inventory of what's already on your shelf so that you can decide, hey, let's move this stuff. Let's move these shoes. Let's move this canned tuna. If you have a grocery store or a 7-Eleven or something like that, or whatever you have, you move the things that you have because you instead of buying new products to sell, you take inventory of what you already have and then you have a sale. And you begin to move the products that you already have, so you gotta take inventory. You gotta know what's in your store. Well, your heart is a storehouse. Your life, your body is a storehouse. It's a treasure chest. You gotta take inventory. So where do we start with inventory? Well, we could start anywhere. There's hundreds and thousands of gifts that God has placed inside of you. But you know what? Let's start with just three. Let's start with three things that God has given us. Because 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7 says, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but what he has given us is power, love, and a sound mind. So this is just taking inventory. It's going to the Bible to discover what is already in us. So when you start adding up what's in you, wow, I got power, I got love, I got a sound mind. Do you know that if you will just do inventory of these three things and realize these three things are in every child of God. If you've been born again, you have these three things dwelling inside of you. You have power, you have love, and you have a sound mind. Now, you might not be using those three things. How many know? Have you ever heard somebody tell you, come on, boy, use your head. Come on, why don't you use your head? In other words, they're saying you have a head, but you're not using it. Use your brain. You have a brain, but you're not using it. Well, use your sound mind. You have the mind of Christ. You just may not be using it because you don't know how Christ thinks. So that's why we need to fast from wrong thinking so we realize how Christ thinks. So when we realize how he thinks, we'll start using the mind of Christ and we'll start putting to use the powerful tool of a sound mind that is on the inside of us. And God has given us love and he's given us power. You know, our problems are divided up into three categories. Every problem in life falls into one of these three categories, and these are the three solutions to every problem you'll ever face. 1/3 of your problems will be solved when you discover the power that you have in your life. Another 1/3 of your problems will be solved when you discover the love that you have in your life. And the final 1/3 of the problems of your life will be solved when you discover you have a sound mind. There is no problem you will ever face in life that one of these three things cannot solve. Power, maybe you feel sick and you feel weak. So guess what you need to discover? You need to discover the power that's inside of you. Maybe you feel lonely and rejected and you'll always be alone the rest of your life, or you'll be lonely the rest of your life. You need to discover the love that God has shown you and the love that God has placed in your heart. That will solve all your loneliness problems. And then there's just something called being stupid. And that's a problem that all of us have faced at one time or another. And guess what the solution for stupid is? A sound mind. Come on, somebody's got to help me here today. This is how you use what God has given you. You take inventory. How do you discover the treasure inside of you? Number one, you gotta start shifting your thinking from what you don't have to what you do have. Number two, you've got to take inventory. Start taking inventory of what you have. You know what? I'm gonna get to number three in a minute, but before I do, let me just share with you a few other things. If we're gonna take inventory, these three things are all we really need, but God's so generous, he doesn't just give us these three things. He always goes above and beyond what we could ask or think, and more than we will ever need. And so in Luke 17:29, what's in you? Let's take inventory real quick. What's inside of you? The kingdom of God is in you. Romans 8:11 says the Holy Spirit is in you. 1 Timothy 4:14 says spiritual gifts are in you. 2 Corinthians 4:6 says the treasure's in you. John 17:13 says joy is in you. Romans 5:5 says love is in you. 2 Timothy 1 verse 5 says faith is in you. You don't need more faith. You have faith. You just have to read the word to release your faith and activate your faith. You got to hear God's word and it will activate your faith. What else is in you? Colossians 1:27 says Christ is in you. The anointing is in you. 1 John 3:9 says his nature is in you. 2 Timothy 1:7 we already said his power, love, and a sound mind is in you. All of these things are in you and I'm just scratching the surface of what's inside of you. What do you have in the house? What do you have in the house? Power, love, a sound mind, Christ, the anointing, the Holy Spirit, love. You got peace inside of you. You got the peace that passes understanding down in your heart. Where? Down in your heart. Where? Down in your heart. You got the joy, 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 joy down in your heart. Where? Down in your heart to stay. It's there. It's all inside of you. You see, the Christian life is a life of discovery. It's a life of discovery. There was one of the wealthiest people in his day. His name was Andrew Carnegie. They named Carnegie Hall after him. He was the founder of U.S. Steel. He was one of the richest men in the world. And he became, he had the distinction of having, at the time, this was miraculous, he had 43 millionaires who worked for him at his company. And this was back when, you know how they do stories today about all the billionaires in the world. Well, back in his day, it was an incredible story to be a millionaire. And he had 43 men or women, 43 people that worked for him at his company that would later become U.S. Steel, and they were 43 millionaires. A reporter once asked him how he had found all these millionaires, and Carnegie responded that those men had not been wealthy at all when they were hired, but they had become millionaires as a result of their hard work and their faith that they had in themselves and his faith in them. But then the reporter went on to say, but how did you train these men to become so valuable that you would pay them so much money? And Carnegie replied that men are developed the same way gold is discovered. Several tons of dirt must be moved to find 1 ounce of gold in the ground. Several tons of dirt must be moved to find 1 ounce of gold in the ground. Let me ask you something. Did moving the dirt put the gold there, or did moving the dirt simply discover the gold that was always there? And what we need to do is we need to remove some layers of wrong thinking in our heads and some layers of wrong believing in our hearts. And as we remove those layers of wrong thinking and as we remove those layers of wrong believing, we will discover the gold that is inside of us. Michelangelo said that when he made the statue of David out of a block of marble, do you know that several artists and sculptors tried to make something out of the same piece of marble that later became the statue of David, and they threw that piece of marble in a backyard trash area, and this is 500, 600 years ago, and Michelangelo saw it, and he was passing by this junk area. And as he passed by this broken, damaged block of marble, he didn't say, oh, I think I could make a David out of that. He literally is quoted as saying, as soon as he saw this broken, thrown out piece of marble, he saw David inside of the marble. And so he went to grab that piece of marble and he began to carve away the things that were in the way of you seeing the David that he saw the whole time. He saw David the whole time, but he had to carve away the pieces of the marble that were preventing everybody else from seeing David. Now, if you go to the museum in Florence where the statue of David is, you will be blown away at the magnificent, greatest creation of any artist, in my opinion, is this statue that he made, because David was always in there. And there's a David inside of you, and God is chipping away the wrong thinking and chipping away the wrong beliefs and chipping away your wrong attitudes, because he knows the David that's on the inside of you. He knows the greatness that's on the inside of you. He knows the treasure that's on the inside of you, but that treasure can't come forth if we don't remove the layers of dirt or remove the broken marble around our David, so that we begin to release the beauty and release the awesomeness and release the greatness that's on the inside of us. That's why we renew our minds. That's why we come to church. What are we doing here? We're not making you something. We're etching away the things that life has brought to you, and life has covered up your treasure. And we're removing the dirt, and we're removing the marble, and we're removing the things that are the things that are in the way of seeing the real you. This is what taking inventory is all about. Renewing your mind is all about. The next thing that brought breakthrough in this woman's life is found in verse 3 of 2 Kings chapter 4. And it says, notice what it says. So then he said to her, she said, all I have is this jar of oil. In verse 2, he said, what do you have in your house? And she said, I don't have anything except this jar of oil. And so he said, then go borrow vessels from everywhere, from all your neighbors, empty vessels, and don't gather just a few. Now, I'm going to have to just talk for a moment, if you'll let me be an evangelist here today. I'm your pastor all the rest of the time, but I need to be an evangelist here for a moment. A vessel represents a human being. And what does he say? He says, go and bring vessels. Go everywhere and bring vessels. Does that sound familiar? It sounds like when Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And what is the condition of every vessel before they meet Jesus? They're empty. They're empty. What is the condition of every human soul and every human heart without Jesus? They're empty. And what is God telling us? Go and get vessels from everywhere. Don't just get them from, you know, don't just get them from where you're comfortable with. He said, go to all your neighbors, not just the black ones because you're black, not just the white ones because you're white, not just the Puerto Rican ones because you're Puerto Rican, not just the Mexican ones because you're Mexican. He said, not just the women because you're a woman, not just the men because you're, now don't be a man that's an evangelist to women. You're not, your objective, your goal is not to go and find all the unsaved women in the world, gentlemen. But that, maybe that's one way to find the one you're looking for, I guess. Just try, get them saved first. We're not supposed to just find people like us. We're not just supposed to find the neighbors we like. He says, go to all your neighbors and borrow vessels, empty vessels. People are empty. People are lonely. People are hurting. They need God. We got to... Hey, you want a breakthrough in your life? Do something for somebody else. Realize people are empty. You got something. You may not have everything you need, but you got something. You may not have everything you want. We mostly do have everything we need. You may not have everything you want, but your vessel has been filled by God. Your vessel is filled with love. Your vessel is filled with goodness. We just did an inventory. You have power, love. You have a sound mind. Your vessel is filled, but there's so many people next to you, so many people in your neighborhood, so many people that are empty, and they don't have the love that you have. They don't have the power you have. They don't have the sound mind that you have. Go and find them and gather them and bring them into the house. He says, go to them and bring them into the house. The church is the house of God. Go and bring them. Go and get them. Folks, if we all just went and got one person this year, we would double as a church. If we just went one person, we would double as the number of people that are going to heaven rather than people going to hell. Think about what you could do if you just see other people as empty vessels that God has called you to bring into the house. We're called to bring them into the house. We're called to win souls and gather the vessels and go everywhere from all the neighborhoods and not be afraid of the neighborhood where it's dangerous or the neighborhood where that's not my kind of people or the neighborhood where they don't have the kind of social status I have. Well, you just self-righteous thing. You got to stop worrying about your social status and worrying about heaven and hell status, because there are people that are lost and going to hell, and they need you to gather them and bring them into God's house. But the next point here, now that I'm back to being your pastor, he said, don't gather just a few. What is he saying? He's saying we got to stop thinking small. If we're going to have a breakthrough in our life, we have to elevate our expectation. We have to start thinking big. We have to start believing big. We have to elevate our expectation. We have to start expecting bigger things than we ever imagined. We got to stop thinking about just ourselves. Because the person that says, oh, I don't need anything, I just need enough for myself, that's a selfish person. If you only need enough for yourself, then you're just thinking about yourself. I want to have more. I want to have an abundance of wisdom, so I have wisdom to give. I want to have an abundance of joy, so I have joy to give. I want to have an abundance of love, so I have love to give. I want to have an abundance of faith, so I have faith to give. I want to have an abundance of money, so I have money to give. I want to have an abundance of blessing, so I have blessing to give. How many know we're blessed to be a blessing? And we need to think big. We need to dream big. We need to elevate our expectations. So what do we do so far to experience our breakthrough? We have to start shifting our thinking to, from what we don't have to what we do have. Then we need to start taking inventory of what is inside of us. Then we need to start elevating our expectations. And I got two more things for you. Here they are. Number four is found in verse four. And notice what he says. Once you bring all those vessels into the house, he said, and when you've come in, shut the door behind you and your sons. Shut the door behind you and your sons. In other words, what is he saying? He's saying that we need to shut the door to some things in order for our miracle to happen, because a breakthrough is about to happen in her life, but she's got to shut the door to some things. She's got to shut the door to some previous ways she used to think. She's got to shut the door to unbelief. Remember when Jesus went to go heal the little girl, when the father Jairus came and said, my little girl is dying, come and lay hands on her. And he starts coming to her house and she dies along the way. And when he gets there, all the people were crying. And he says, she's not dead, she's just sleeping. And they started ridiculing him. In Mark chapter 5, verse 40, it says, and they ridiculed him, but when he had put them all outside. Notice what he did. And whenever I see this vision of putting them all outside, now this is going to date me, but the only image I can remember or recollect when I think of these words, I think of the Fred Flintstone, the beginning of the Flintstones, when the lion or the pet or whatever, the cat, what is it? No, but he puts the cat outside and then the cat goes in and puts him outside, right? That was Dino that did that, or no, that was the cat, right? The tiger, it was the tiger, yeah. He puts the tiger, saber-tooth tiger, he puts the tiger outside, and then the tiger jumps through the window and puts Fred outside. He puts Fred outside, and you know, and he's, you know, Wilma, right? I don't know why that came to me, but it's my juvenile thinking. We have to put some things outside and shut the door. We have to shut the door to our old thinking. We have to shut the door to some people that aren't good for our faith. We have to shut the door to the haters, the gossipers, the self-righteous, the judges of everybody, the spiritual policemen that want to police your lifestyle and say, oh, I saw you smoking that cigarette when you left church. So what? At least you came to church. I'd rather you leave smoking than not come at all. Because if you keep coming, God's going to fill you to where you don't need the smoke anymore. You got the smoke of the Holy Ghost. I'd rather you keep coming. Did you see how the pastor hugged that person? I know what that person was doing. I wonder if the pastor's doing it too, because I know what that person. We're loving people unconditionally here. I don't know about you, but we love people unconditionally. We teach people uncompromisingly, and we encourage people unceasingly. We're here to serve people. We're here to love people. We're here to introduce them to the love of God. Jesus, everybody was a sinner that Jesus came in contact with. He didn't surround himself with the saints because there weren't any. There were just ain'ts. They weren't no saints. And he surrounded himself with them because he wanted to have an impact in their lives. We got to stop being afraid of people coming into our church that are struggling with things. Maybe they're struggling with an addiction, or they're struggling with their identity, or they're struggling with some sin, or they're struggling with figuring out, is this okay? Does God permit this? Does God allow this? And we have to stop defining the holiness that everybody else needs to be walking in, and just, the Bible says, be responsible for yourself. Examine your own faith to see, examine yourself to see if you're in the faith. We got to stop examining everybody else. But those that are always examining everybody else, you need to put them out of your life. People that are self-righteous judges of everybody, you got to shut the door on some of those people. Come on, help me now. You got to shut the door on people that want to stop you from your dreams and stop you from believing for better things, and people that are always making fun of your faith and, oh, how come you're tithing, or I can't believe you speak in tongues. Oh, you still go to that church? Don't you know what's wrong with that Life Changers church? They painted the church gray and white. They must not know what real color is. Let me tell you what real color is. Look around, you sucker. That's real color. We got white, we got black, we got Hispanic, we got Puerto Rican, we got Mexican, we got Asian, we got Chinese, Japanese. Tell you what color is. Is he mad? No, I'm playing with you. But I know what color is, and it's all around here. If I didn't mention your nation or your color, forgive me. But this right here, folks, is the Rainbow Coalition. And when you can gather this many people from this many walks of life, you know that we have a common denominator. And what our common denominator is, the love of God and the power of the Holy Spirit and the goodness of God and the grace of God and the gift of righteousness. We got to shut the door. We got to shut the door on wrong people. We got to shut the door on needing attention. These people that we brought up to this stage today, they didn't need the attention. They didn't ask for the attention. They just want to serve. Some of them are crying on their way up here. They're walking up here to receive praise, and they're not looking for praise. And that's when you're going to find it, when you're not looking for it, when all you're seeking is for the glory of God, the praise that comes from Him. That's what we live for. Not the praise of other people. We got to shut the door to needing attention. And then finally, the fifth secret to discovering the treasure that's inside of you is also found in 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 4. He says, "And when you come in, shut the door behind you, you and your sons, then pour into those vessels and set aside the full ones." Pour into those vessels, pour into those vessels, pour into those vessels. What does this mean? This means here is the greatest secret to me, the final concluding secret to discovering the treasure inside of you is when you take the oil that's inside of you and take the inventory of what's inside of you and start pouring it in others. You're pouring it in empty vessels. You're pouring it into people that are hurting. You're pouring it into the people that walk through the doors of the church. You're pouring it into people through our outreach and evangelism. You're pouring it into people as we give to missions. You're pouring it into people as we hit the streets and win souls. You're pouring it into people when you serve in our children's ministry. You're pouring it into empty vessels when single mothers come to the church and they can barely carry their purse and their child and their carriage and all the things that they got to bring, and you go out and help them, and you open the door for them, and you park their car for them without stealing their car, and you just do. You're out to serve. You're out to pour. You're pouring. You're pouring. You're pouring. You're going to have a breakthrough when you start pouring what you have into others. Sometimes we're waiting for somebody to pour into us, but every time you come through the doors here and you sit in the seat here, I'm pouring into you, and God's pouring into you, and we're pouring into you, and we're unleashing the oil that's inside of you and the treasure that's inside of you. But now, what do you do? You don't wait for a job. You don't wait to be paid to do it, but you start pouring into others. You don't wait for somebody to say, "Oh, you're so great." You just take inventory of what's inside of you, and you say, "I'm here to serve, because the greatest among us is the servant of all." If we will start pouring. What do we need to do? We need to start shifting our thinking from what we don't have to what we do have. We need to start taking inventory of what's inside of us. We need to start elevating our thinking and elevate our expectations to think bigger than we've ever thought before. And what else do we need to do? We need to start shutting the door to the wrong thoughts, the wrong people, the wrong attitudes about ourselves. And then finally, what do? We need to start pouring into others. Start pouring into others. Go out into the lobby and sign up to be a volunteer. Become a volunteer in this church. There are many entry points. You can enter in, like some of these people, they're serving in 5 areas, but you can enter in and just start serving in 1 area. You can start serving every Sunday, or you can start serving once a month, but you can start somewhere. Everybody can start pouring somewhere. Pour into our children's ministry, pour into our youth, pour into our music department, pour into the offering, pour into being a sacrificial giver. Some of you have a gift of making money. That means you have a gift of giving money. You just might not have discovered the second gift. So I'm here to announce to you that if you have the gift of making money, you have the gift of giving it too. So start pouring into others. Start pouring into the house of God, because this is the house where breakthroughs are going to happen. This is the house where miracles are going to happen. And this is the house that God wants to blow up and increase and expand and reach more people and more souls and more nations and more nationalities and more colors and more races than we ever have before. Let's stand together.